Let me start with acknowledging the people who did the work. Amar, he made this Lynx data portal I will show you about. Ray, he did a lot of the data processing, standardization, all of that. Graduate students did a lot of data curation. I show you some results of that. So all of the people here, they're involved in two NIH consortia. I want to mostly talk about one. This is Lynx Data Coordination and Integration Center that you see there. And I want to acknowledge the other PIs, Avi Mayan in Mount Sinai and Mario Medvedovic. They're like amazing scientists and collaborators on that. And of course, it's funded by the NIH. You know, via this grant, without that, it wouldn't exist. And last but not least, I want to really acknowledge Kerm Akson. It's great to be here. People in my group, they use your tools a lot, every day, some of them. And I use it for teaching as well. We use the Postgres cartridge in the data portal I will show you. And you know, I can't add a lot to what you showed in the beginning of the conference, but other than saying thank you, it's really great, you know, how you guys make research, enable research and teaching. And I'm really happy to see how far the company has come, you know, in 20 years. So thank you guys so much, you know, so it's very enabling. Right, so this Library of Integrated Network-Based Cellular Signatures Consortium, short Lynx, is a consortium of six data and signature generation centers. Each of them are also like little consortia, they are shown there. And like the data coordination center that are the three sites that I mentioned, Avi, Mario, and myself down in Miami. And if you think about this data, so what is happening is that these centers generate perturbation data in disease models, and in this case in cells. And you can think of this data like in three dimensions. One is this kind of the model system. So it's like a disease model. Those are all cells, right? Different cell types, but all cell data. And then you can think of perturbations. And perturbations include like small molecules, genetic perturbations, antibodies, microenvironments, and then the type of signatures or the assay, and then include genome-wide transcription and profiling, P100, phosphoproteomics, global chromatin profiling, biochemical signatures, you know, all kinds of like image-based morphological features and so on, right? So those are the cellular readouts, right? And then the consortium also develops a lot of tools, and I will just show you like, you know, one or two today. But there are a lot of resources being developed, right? And you see the website lynxproject.org down there, so you can get a lot of information there. But our job now as this data coordination integration center is kind of to take all this data, transcriptional imaging, epigenetics, what you see here, and kind of harmonize it all, kind of bring it all together and make it accessible to the public, right, in some kind of reasonably easy way, right? So that's our job. And you see this Lynx data portal, it's kind of one of the products out of that, the URL there, right? But before I get into this, so to do this, why do we want to do this? Why is this somehow important, right? Is those fair guiding principles that I mentioned in the title. And those, you probably, you know, are aware of those. They're now, you know, becoming widely endorsed by publishers, funders, journals. And there's a lot of work going on. This is a high priority to basically make data that's generated, you know, in particular in those research consortia and from public money, right? This is happening internationally in the US and also in Europe, to make them findable. So that means having identifiers, right? Having qualified metadata annotations, having them indexed so you find them on the web, have them accessible and attributable. So you have them, you have an open and free protocol, right? To access the data, have them interoperable, right? So that we know the data is somehow interlinked with other types of data, achieve that via formal representations of knowledge, vocabularies, ontologies, and importantly, make them reusable, right? Again, by having like, having a clear license, but also having clear metadata, so they can be integrated and provenance on those as well. And then replicable, it's a little bit less our responsibility as a data coordination center. But of course, we also want to provide enough experimental annotations so that a user can at least understand, you know, if they want to trust the data or not, right? So that's important. So now in our group in Miami, we developed this entire processing pipeline from receiving the data, submitted from this data generation centers. We via a submission tool, a web-based submission tool, via APIs, or file submission via a server, and basically submitting metadata, assay metadata, reagent metadata, data set metadata, experimental metadata, the processing pipelines, how the data were processed, you know, from the raw data all the way to the final signatures, and then the data files, right, with everything in there. Then a validation step, and there are simple validations to look for completeness. You know, are the proper ontology ontology terms used? Are the fields properly mapped? Looking at the pipelines, right? Mario's group does reproduce all the pipelines and make sure they actually work. They're all published on GitHub, or at least most of them. But the goal is to have that all there. And then also look at verifying the reagent registrations, right? And then actually do registering the data. So in a specialized registration environment, right? And then mapping it to external references for chemical information, but also for cell information and other types of information, right? And then make a data set package that packages to them all the data files and all the metadata, and then kind of do some QC on that, right? And now this data set package ends up in this data portal that I will show you like in a second. But now the next thing we are doing, we're taking then all these data packages now and putting it, essentially extracting it, mapping it back to all the metadata, and putting it all like in something that we call a signature database, a signature store. And we're working on a model that is kind of a hybrid of a relational and an object store. So we have all these signatures basically in a Mongo database, and you can access that all. You can query essentially any subset of that reasonably quickly. And this is kind of what we are trying to do now in the data coordinator, to make it really like kind of easy to use the data. And then, like you mentioned, like one of the ways we export also is Hadoop, right? You can put it then in Hadoop, you can do computation on it. It makes it easy to do things in R. And on larger scale and so on, right? So this is what we are working on. So, okay, let me talk about the data portal a little bit. This is where we use some Chemaxon tools. So what you see here is an overview page. This numbers change, you know, this is probably a little bit updated now, but you see the data sets, small molecules, cells, and you see like those different columns here. You can explore all the data based on general areas like, you know, transcriptomics, proteomics, or what kind of experimental methods are used, what the centers are, what the projects are, and so on. And you can go there, for example, here you see there are 163 like kinome scan data sets. These are like kinome-wide profiling data, right? And then if you go to any of those data set pages, so they are organized like having a lot of information there. You see those different tabs, the description, and so on, right? And you see the links IDs. We can cite the data, so we basically create a unique identifier using the Miriam registry at EBI and then the identifier.org resolution service. So there can be a unique, persistent, kind of Perl-like identifier, PUL-like identifiers generated, and then other citation information, so you can actually cite all those data sets. And then you see like the other tab, like metadata, you see small molecule metadata, cell metadata, and other information, right? And then we can also download the data, right? The different data levels you see there on the left side, right? Those are raw, this is basically a processed raw data all the way to signature level data. And then these you can also individually cite, right? And then what we have, of course, some kind of components for the small molecules. You see this here on the left. There's some basic statistics about, you know, clinical approved drug and clinical phase and where they're coming from. And then the same for cell lines. I will talk a little bit about the small molecule side. So essentially, the important part here, I guess, is substructure search. You can use Marvin.js to draw a structure. The cartridge is then being queried, right? You can get those results back here. You see them here. You see there on the left, there are a bunch of facets, right? One of them sees approved drug, clinical phase. So you could, just select only the approved drugs. You know, it would just update this. What you can do is you can type in any text, which will figure out if it's a name or a target or like a mechanism of action or something, and then find the appropriate data sets, or in this case compounds, but the same works in all the other interfaces for cells and data sets. And then you see those little symbols there on the top for the compounds, the downloads, the cells, and all of that, and this is all interactive, so you can then click on those and find the relevant related data sets. All right, so now you can go in there, click on something, and we also built like a little like similarity search. You see this there, the pull down, and you can now look at imatinib, right? The first approved kinase drug for CML, chronic myeloid leukemia. I can find the most similar compounds. So we use this functionality a little bit. I would have to say that it's probably or potentially a little overkill. You know, there are only 50,000 compounds in there, but we're gonna like expand this a little bit more and also maybe see like what other more relevant and more extensive chemical information we can bring in there. You also see there on the site like a little bit of an overview, right, of what the data sets are, how many data sets there are for each of those compounds. And then you see like a couple of annotations, right, like the drug annotations, mechanism of action, pharmacological classification, and so on, and how many cells and all of that. So there's a bit of information in there to figure out what we know about those compounds. All right, so this is, I don't want to go through the entire process here, but this is now how kind of how we process those chemical structures. It's not such a nice solution as what you have, like a really nice interface with registration, right? So we do this, we're getting a data file, right? And then we're processing it in this way. So it's a pre-processing step to get to kind of filter out everything that is kind of a special case, like metal organic compounds that requires manual curation, right? It gets standardized using also like some Chemaxon tools. And then, of course, you know, if the structure is already known, it will just get mapped. Or if not, then we assign a new ID and we map it internally. We have some databases where we already aggregated all the Campbell data into unique like bioactivity structure pairs, right? So that we have them kind of like aggregated so there aren't like too many replicates. And then also service-based mapping to PubChem and do property calculations and then put all this in this like small molecule database and then serve it up, all the metadata and all the information I showed you, compound information, data set information, and the chemical compound information via this Lynx data portal interface that I showed you, right? And then the chemical structure is like, I mean, you guys all know this. We have the Postgres cartridge, and then there's a little servlet in the middle, right, that basically brings the information back to the interface, and the structure search uses MarvinJS or directly like in this interface, just the similarity based on the query structure, right? So this is kind of how this looks from the user perspective, right? It's fairly straightforward, right? In this case, valproic acid, right? You basically see there's a salt submitted, right? This gets reviewed, then the salts get stripped off, right? There's some protonation generating the tautomers, then deciding on the canonical reasonable tautomer one, right? And then essentially generate the small molecule, Lynx small molecule ID. You see this here in the interface, and then we map that to PubChem via the services and also via the Unichem service at EBI to a lot of other databases. They're mapped to about 80 databases, so it's quite useful to be able to do that. And then we also generate this Lynx LSM ID is this LSM is registered into Miriam, so that means now this becomes a kind of a Perl identifier, right? And this can potentially then be resolved via this identifier.org service anywhere we want, right? So if this essentially at some point lives somewhere else, then that can also point to whatever location that will be, right? The ID remains the same, right? This Lynx LSM ID. Right, so now if we do this, right, you see here three examples. This is of course what happens a lot. The first two are just simple imidazole tautomers, right? Then you have this other version, is this like slightly less favorable de-aromatized version, right? That also exists. All of those are in the database, you know, at one of the centers. And then of course you standardize this. It's not a big problem, right? And you get your standardized ID, and everything is great. And you just see the statistics here of how many like representations there are for each of those. So this is also not too surprising. But what I will do is I show you like some of the more semi-depressing situations. So this case here, right? So this is not formally incorrect, right? But we're having if you query PubChem, right? You're getting this representation there on the right. So you're having a more complex situation here, right? Where you nitroso compound now is kind of represented like a hydroxylamine, right? And you're having like basically this double bond. You have this easy, right? Because this could all get interconverted, you know, together into what you see and like many many more tautomeric versions, right? With Chemaxon and also like looking at other tools, you know, we just use this version that I think is like more reasonable than what you see there. But it's not formally wrong, right? But there are cases where it gets wrong. Here, right, in addition to this, again, the similar case of how to tautomerize this ring system, right? You're now having this, you see the stereocenters, right? And also this is a meso compound that's symmetric, right? There's still a difference between axial and axial equatorial or axial equatorial configuration. It's, you cannot just delete those stereocenters, right? Because they're still relative, and that's what happens in some cases, right? So that's, you could say it's kind of wrong, because there's still the other relative configuration, right? So here, this is a case where, you know, for some reason, PubChem would decide to add like a proton, and you know, because they come up with this quaternary nitrogen, and it's not wrong, but what is wrong, that there should be another negative charge, right? And we're just removing one of the hydrogens, but that's not the case. So it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of wrong. You know, the molecular mass wouldn't even be the same in this case. So it's problematic, and you have this typical problems like metal organic compounds, right? So here, I mean, you could represent it like this. This is something that I think makes some kind of sense. Similar cases for like cis platinum, you know, it's a common thing. But you could represent it as ionic, right? But you cannot just protonate them and then, you know, make the chrome neutral and then have that. That's also not correct, right? So those are all the cases we can catch, right? We just have to do query PubChem, a couple of other resources, find all the conflicts and go through them and make a decision, right? So that can probably be further automated, but it's doable to manage all of those, right? So now it really becomes like a problematic, right? Is if you're getting submissions, right? Like in this case, partenolite, right? And essentially, you know, different versions of stereo isomers in this case. And since there isn't like, at this point at least, a nice interactive registry that looks at every molecule and puts it like in a queue, right, for review, we're getting those, you know, and we realized, you know, there are a lot of those different versions, you know, they don't necessarily show up conflicts, but they're also in other databases in the same, you know, not all of them are right, obviously there's only one real partenolite, right? So what we did is we took all of the compounds from the database, we organized them all based on name similarity, a submitted name, and then also based on chemical similarity, grouped them all into groups, and then grad students like basically looked at all of those groups, you know, and looked at all of those and basically reviewed them. And you see here, you know, this is like some preliminary results I'm showing you of that. So you see like, you know, 1,700 submitted, mapped to 500 correct structures so far, like 60% complete. I'll show you like a summary in the end, right? But I'll show you like some examples. Again, this is like maybe a more common example, right? Rapamycin, this is a sirolimus, immunosuppressant. It's a natural product with several stereocenters. You get all kinds of versions, right? Geometric configuration changes, different stereochemistry. And though they also appear like in PubChem, Kebby, and Campbell, right? So this is not, but there isn't really a very good way to figure out what's the correct one, unless you really do the research, right? So it's this one, right? So now, again, it's a similar example, right? So we probably don't need to go through this. Again, stereochemical information, right? Except in this case, you know, what I just showed you, that R was submitted as S and S was submitted as R, so the naming wasn't matching, right, to the structure that was submitted. So, but, you know, I guess that could also be corrected, you know. So here's a case, you know, where we have Lipitor, like atorvastatin, right? And you have, again, like a version, often this happens, stereocenters are ignored, right? But then also like there's a mix-up in some database, you know, where actually spiramycin is submitted as under the name atorvastatin. Okay, we're starting again. You're going to have a very big challenge to filter that out of the video. I'm just going to speak up a little bit. So you see that, you know, basically an antibiotic is submitted under this name, right? So it's completely wrong, but it's not necessarily trivial to find, you know, unless you check it, right? So there are also other examples here of a mismatch of submitted name and structure, right? Where you basically have this dihydroxyphenylalanyl GABA, right? But it's a completely different structure, right? So now you have to do some research, figure out, okay, what would be the correct name? What would be the structure corresponding to the name? Do some searches, verify what they really did, and then and kind of clean it up, right? Another example of this you see here, you know, like submitted name. So Nizamit, here you see what that actually is on the right side, right? And then amino benztropine would be that, right? And another example, you know, amino benztropine submitted, but it's again the wrong structure, you know. So this would actually be adapiperazine, right? So and then it's really hard to figure out what's actually going on here, right? What do they really have in that sample that actually has the screening data, right? So it requires a lot of forensics to actually figure out what's going on. It can even come directly from the source, right? Here we have this etodolac anti-inflammatory agent is a COX-2 inhibitor. And it's reported that the S isomer is solely responsible for this effect, and the R isomer is reported to be inactive, but SelectChem shows this as this COX-2 inhibitor, but it's the wrong stereoisomer, right? So we reported this to them, and they're looking at looking now into it, what they actually have really there, right? Do they have the COX inhibitor, or do they have what they write there on the in the chemical structure, right? So even that happens, and unless you do the digging and the forensics, it's very hard to actually figure out what you really have. And I guess you want to know, you know, if this is really the COX inhibitor or not, if you do genome by transcriptional profiling, right? So this is how this looks so far. So here you see like the groups, right? They would represent one unique structure. You know, if you did it correct, of course, this is not always correct, but roughly. And then you would see the number of submitted distinct chemical structures, right? So you see, you know, if you look at this, you know, it looks like a little bit like half of them could be wrong, right? So, you know, I'm not sure if this is like scales to everything that we have submitted, right? So we were just discussing at, in the break, maybe we can use somehow like chemicalize, you know, and do like a more statistical analysis, see how bad the situation really is. But, you know, this is not, doesn't look like so great. But I want to end on a little bit a more positive note than that. So, I mean, I would also say, you know, this is, I think this is probably a persistent problem if you don't have chemists in the loop who register all your structures, right? And it's a problem that is particularly related to a consortium, right? If you're one company, right, you can have your own business rules, you can have it all reasonably organized internally, but if you're getting data from all kinds of sources, right, then you're having this kind of challenges because all of those people use different operational informatics systems, right? Some of them don't even have anything. They're just, or they don't even know how to draw a structure, right? So they would just, you know, draw something, it's semi-right. So for some of those groups, we redraw everything for them because it was all wrong, you know? So anyway, so we did a, but if you do the cleanup, right, and you do a good, as good a job as possible, we can do a lot of like useful annotations for those links compounds. And you see them, right? We have like about like 1,200 drug, FDA approved drug annotations, right? 380 with a clinical phase, 1-3, chemical probes mapped to PubChem, right? Here you see like the average target annotations that we have for all of those drugs. So of course there are many other targets for drugs than the one that is reported to be the mechanism of action. So those information are all there, right? And we have like overall a number of disease indications from experimental factor ontology and MASH, reference mechanism of action from different resources, and then those unique unique compound target bioactivity annotations. And here we only used like high quality, like concentration response data, so no like single concentration or something. It should be reasonably reliable to do this, right? Of course, we all know, right, if we look at the distribution, I think there was actually a similar figure before. If you look at the distribution of how many target annotations we have, it's highly sparse, right? So some of them have a lot, but most of them don't have. The actual ratio is about, you know, 2-1. So what we also working on, like we can, for example, take all the kinase data. Just as an example, here on the left, you see the kinase activity, the kinase data points per kinase, you know, how many compounds we have that have some kind of activity for this kinase. And you see here different cutoffs, right? Like less than 1 micromolar or less than 100 nanomolar. And then on the right, you see mapped all the approved drugs on the kinome tree, right? We aggregate this data from a couple of different sources. And then what one can do is one can then use this to make models, right? And we did like a little like a test here, make a neural net to basically predict kinase activities for compounds, right? And this is there, this KNET, CCS Miami EDU. It also has a little drawing component, which is Marvin.js. So try it out if you want to. But there's not enough time to talk about this, but I just want to mention it. You know, it's kind of interesting. So we can add computer annotations potentially, right? While of course making clear that they're computed and not real. And that With that, I want to just mention one other project. So this is also quite relevant for another project we're getting involved in now. This is called Illuminating a Druggable Genome, IDG. This is, again, a consortium that you see here. The website, druggablegenome.net. Reasonably easy to remember. It's a little bit like an analog or parallel system to the open targets in Europe, if you're aware of that. The aim here, the goal of this project is to essentially prioritize understudied targets for which there isn't much known, right? So what happens is that in industry as well as in academia, most people work on something that is already well studied. People have all kinds of terms that I probably shouldn't repeat for this kind of like behavior. But it's one consequence of risk aversion, right? And that, but you know, and NIH realized this. This comes out of work published many years ago, and essentially now has also a consortium with several groups, and they are basically working on GPCRs, kinases, and ion channels, and essentially prioritizing them, and trying to make it easier for people and de-risk the work on those kind of like understudy targets, right? And this includes a knowledge management center and also centers who make probes or make other kind of tools to study those targets, right? So this is also another interesting project I think is worth to be aware of. So with that, I want to thank everybody again. Thank you, Chemaxon, for making a lot of this possible. And if you have questions, I can answer them. Or you can also contact me if you are interested in anything else. Or if you have any problems with those tools, just let me know. And then hopefully we can help you.
So when you were mentioning the tautomerization problems, what was the method that finally used?
So basically what we ended up doing, yeah. Right? So we actually used a bunch of tools, you know, like, and then what we did is really we made our own standardization pipeline, right? And then we queried with our standardized structures, we queried PubChem, the PubChem service, the PUG service, and then we take that PubChem result, use the same standardization pipeline and compare everything and identify all the conflicts, and then we review them, you know.
But for tautomerization, you also use this one? For tautomer handling?
Yeah, for the entire processing pipeline, right? Yeah, mostly, I mean, a lot of this comes back to tautomerization problems, I think, you know.
Okay, so we're not using neither Chemaxon nor the Inchibon?
No, we use the Chemaxon tools in looking at tautomerization, yeah.
Okay.
But it's just challenging because not everybody is using it, you know.
It's true.
And then we used also some other tools, you know, like so they all behave a little bit different. But I think the key is maybe it doesn't even matter that much if there's one, as long as it works correct and doesn't do things wrong, you know. So we can give you guys some examples. You know, we have lots of examples with challenges. I can send them, you know.
Yeah, that would be great. Thank you.
Any other questions? Stefan, I do have one. Who's the main consumer for what you're doing? Is it other universities? Is it pharma? Who's
so both, all of them, right? So you can call them like bioinformatics people, right? Or computational biologists, right? To use that data. There are a lot of tools if you go there, you know, to basically analyze all the data, build tools on top. There are pharma companies, they're very interested in this data. I think it's fairly useful. And then there are also, of course, NIH is very interested in building tools that can be used by, you know, kind of non-computational people, right? So they can query about, show me everything that's known about this compound, right? How does it change the transcriptome, right, in these different cells, right? What's happening in proteomics, right? What are the known targets in all of those types of things, right? So you have all of those users, and the goal is to essentially make it accessible to those different types of user groups, right?
So it looks to me that you solve basically a small molecule compound registration problem. So why don't so have you considered compound registration for this?
Actually, we haven't really considered it for that because we kind of did it because we did it ourselves, you know. So we kind of like, I guess, had probably something that maybe you end up with a reasonably similar outcome, except that we didn't do it do it like maybe totally right from the beginning, right? I think if a consortium had a way to essentially register all their stuff themselves, right? So we're now building a dataset submission system that allows to submit all the metadata, the compound, the cells, the data files, everything, right, together. And if that would also be chemically intelligent, I think it would be a big benefit because, and then if it also could identify already at the source those conflicts, right, between names and structures, right, and all of that. So then I think that could be beneficial, you know, for probably not only that consortium, but anybody who works with chemical structures, right, and where there is some kind of like big need to you know have it you know correct, which I guess should always be there. You know?
Yeah, in compound registration there is a staging area where there is a place where you can debug actually anything which goes to wrong path. So.
Yeah, so it would have to be something that is, I mean, I guess it's all web-based, you know, and it would just have to be kind of integrated with the other, but I think it's something to consider. Maybe a little bit too late for this particular consortium, but I think it's something worthwhile to consider kind of the next time, or even, I mentioned to some of you earlier, we also are involved in this NIH Data Commons, right? So NIH is having a big priority to putting basically all the data, exploring how it works in the cloud. And then you know, there's obviously going to be a need, right, to submit the data to those resources. And well, if it's chemical data, then I mean, it would be very important, right, to not just dump everything in there and have some kind of more formal process, right? So I think there are opportunities to do that. You know?